Welcome to Music Majors Unplugged. Do you want to find your place in the world of music and succeed in a career? Do you find yourself up late at night thinking about what your next steps should be? Do you have ambitious goals but are unsure how to pursue them? Hello, my name is Aiden and I too was and still am a college student who wants to pursue music for a living but is unsure of what steps to take. I too feel overwhelmed with all of the things that I've tried to do to further my career and wished everything would just fall into place. I wanted to win a job, I wanted to be accepted into a summer festival, and I wanted to make a living in music, but I kept telling myself that I wasn't a strong enough player and that maybe music was not for me. I discovered that masterclasses were where I learned the best. Just listening and talking to professionals is the easiest way to learn about where you want to take your career in the future. In this podcast, you will learn about new career paths, listen to professionals that are working in the industry, and learn advice to take yourself to the next level so you can find your place in music. Welcome back to Music Majors Unplugged. My name is Aiden. I'm your host today, and today we have Evan Chapman. Evan Chapman is based in Philadelphia as a percussionist, composer, and filmmaker who has built a prolific and unique career by seamlessly blending multimedia and contemporary music. Chapman is a founding member of contemporary classical percussion trio slash rock band Square Peg Round Hole, whose original compositions have been dubbed a creative adventure by Bob Boilen, NPR, and have received further acclaim from Modern Drummer Magazine, Pace Magazine, and Mental Floss, among others. Chapman is also a founder and owner of film production company 410 Media alongside longtime collaborator Kevin Eikenberg. The duo's background as classically trained percussionists has allowed them to create fresh and musically authentic representations of pieces in the contemporary classical and pop worlds. 410's client list includes internationally acclaimed artists such as New York Philharmonic, Steve Reich, Caroline Shaw, the Bang on a Can All-Stars, So Percussion, David Lang, Sun Lux, Alarm Will Sound, The Crossing Choir, Third Coast Percussion, and many more. Yeah, so after that, welcome to the podcast. Thank you so much for being here.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Why don't you just tell us a little bit about yourself, your background in music, and how you came to where you are now?
Sure. So I grew up playing drum set in garage rock bands. That was my thing. I was fully drum set for, you know, all through grade school and high school. And towards the end of high school, it was pretty clear to me that I wanted to major in music. I actually didn't really feel like I had any other choices. Like, that's the only thing that I took seriously and the only thing I cared about at that point. My two options from my perspective seemed to be jazz drum set or classical percussion. There were programs like Berklee College of Music in Boston that had more kind of popular styles, but for most of the schools, those were my two tracks. And even though I was a drum set player, I didn't quite feel at home in the jazz drum set world. I played, you know, jazz and big bands and combos in high school, but didn't really feel like I wanted to go full jazz at that point. And so realized that classical percussion might be a good way to just get as well-rounded of a percussion music education as possible. And so towards the second half of high school, basically scrambled and tried to learn how to hold four sticks in two hands and definitely played some serious catch up. A lot of my friends had already done, you know, some excerpts and marimbas and had like marimba pieces for mallets, fives, and were good at reading mallet, like, you know, reading music. And I just didn't have much of that training. I had studied a little bit of jazz vibraphone in my private lessons, but was pretty much just a drummer at heart. So practiced a bunch, did a lot of four mallet etudes over and over and over again, and tried to get my chops up in time for college auditions. Ended up getting into Indiana University in Bloomington. Somehow they must have seen something in my fumbling around the instruments, which I'm very grateful for to this day. And then things really started to open up for me, and I just saw the possibilities expand once I got to Indiana. Indiana is a very large music school. It, you know, kind of prides itself as a conservatory-esque training, but it's a massive state school, and the music school is very large, and the percussion department had like 60 people in it, which is massive. But, you know, which has its pros and cons, but the major pros were just the large diversity and kind of breadth of what everybody was doing there. There were four professors to study with, and each of them had very, very different expertise. And so I, some people went there knowing that they wanted to be a marimba player and studied with Kevin Bobo their entire time, and that was their track. And I, you know, the whole reason why I decided to go to classical percussion school was to get as well-rounded of a education as possible. And so I basically just did a year per professor. So studied timpani and snare drum with John Tafoya, marimba with Kevin Bobo, and some orchestral excerpts, drum set with Steve Houghton, and then Afro-Cuban and Brazilian percussion with Michael Spiro. And that was kind of where I started to feel the most at home, was studying with Spiro. I ended up spending a lot of time with him and was in all of his ensembles, because the kind of, you know, teaching aurally and by rote and in a room with a bunch of people and learning music and working on music, writing on the spot, that's kind of where I was used to living, playing in rock bands, and that's how a lot of that music functions, Afro-Cuban music and Latin jazz and samba, and it's all, you know, groove-based, layer-based. It's a lot of, like, we're going to start here, we're going to add in this layer, and that's just what I was used to, how I was used to working. So I really felt at home there, and that has continued to play a big part in the music that I write, even now, the stuff I learned with Michael Spiro. All the while, also having this kind of hobby side hustle of taking photos and videos, which goes back until I... goes way back from when I was really small. I always enjoyed having cameras of any kind. I was like... always the kid on elementary school field trips with the disposable camera, like taking pictures of my friends. And then that kind of grew into skateboard videos was a big thing for me and my friends. We had like an old VHS, like our family's VHS camcorder that I would take out to whatever spot that we were skating, and I would film us. And I would actually, in order to get it on the computer, I would like take a digital camera and film the screen of the VHS to get the VHSs onto the computer, because we didn't have like a VHS digitizing machine. So also grew up with my best friend since forever, Kevin Eikenberg. We grew up down the street from each other, and we were both kind of tinkering with cameras throughout, also being, we're both drummers, so we have had very similar tracks our entire life. So once I got to Indiana, I was still taking pictures and videos as a hobby whenever I could. You know, if I was going to a percussion ensemble concert, I would just have a camera in the balcony and I would just kind of be snapping pictures. And gradually the word got out that I liked doing that, and I had some of the equipment that I just built up over the years. And so starting from very, very, you know, small checks, people started to pay me to film their recitals, take their headshots. But there was also just a lot of kind of free, you know, collaboration and experimentation that was going on too. If, you know, a friend was playing a piece and just wanted a video of it for YouTube, you know, I would bring some lights into our percussion studio. And my partner, Kevin, was also doing the same thing at his school, American University in D.C. We were kind of messing around with similar types of work, and then came back together after graduating. Neither of us had any idea what we wanted to do, and kind of saw this niche, that this kind of hole that needed to be filled with classical musicians, contemporary classical musicians, percussionists, needing high quality video. It wasn't really a thing that was happening a ton then. It was a lot of recital videos, static camera on a tripod in the back of the hall. But we were interested in bringing in the colored lights and, you know, doing the cool stuff. And so made the company together, 410, which we officially made the company in early 2016, but had been freelancing together and separately for a while before that. And then from there, it's just been a gradual process of expanding the client list, gradually building ourselves up the various ladders of clients, and just trying to continually do creative and good work whenever we possibly can. And I have also, you know, definitely maintained my identity as a percussionist, composer, drummer since graduation too, and have released some albums, both myself and with my band, Square Peg Round Hole. We also met in Indiana. So yeah, it's just been this kind of multifaceted freelance, very self-built career of video with 410, and then music with myself, and then with my bandmates, Sean and Carlos.
Sweet. So it started just filming people's recitals. Was there a moment when you like received an email from a client or somebody who wanted you to record them, and were you like, oh, this could like be a thing? Did you ever have that moment?
Yeah, actually, I can kind of pinpoint when that was, which was so when I was in, I think it was between my junior and senior year of college, I went to the So Percussion Summer Institute in Princeton, New Jersey, and met the So Percussion guys there, which they've now become good friends and longtime collaborators, and I look up to them, and I think they're amazing. Back then, I was just, you know, a little terrified college kid and was scared to talk to them, but through that connection at SOCI, at their institute, they had asked us a couple years later to, and with the So Percussion Summer Institute, it was the same thing where I just like showed up with a camera and was filming. And even though no one asked me to, it's like, I'm just going to film and take pictures and I'll give them, you know, I'll give the people the things and see if they use them for anything, not expecting to get paid or anything. And a couple years later, So had done a commission by Bryce Desner of a piece called Music for Wooden Strings, which is with these like handmade wooden, they're sort of like guitars, but you play them with various implements like pencils and chopsticks, and really cool piece, about half an hour long. And they were like, we want to film a video of this for Vic Firth for their YouTube channel. Would you want to film this? And that I can vividly remember being kind of the first project that was like, okay, like, this isn't just a concert that's already happening that I'm bringing a camera to. This is like, they want to set up a video shoot with me, and they want like Kevin and me to light it and record it and come up with different angles to do. And so, yeah, I remember Kevin and I taking that very, very seriously. And we like sat down and made this whole shot list of all the shots we wanted. And that was a very exciting, like, first kind of pivoting moment from live documentation going away from that towards just actually doing setup video shoots. And yeah, since then, So has become good, close friends. And that's, that kind of started a long relationship. So yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah. So while you're at Indiana, are you taking classes on filming and editing, or is this all just self-taught kind of through the internet, or what's your education in this media production?
YouTube University. Yeah. I kind of regret it now, not taking more advantage of like recording classes, film classes, composition classes, because I do all of those things now. But yeah, it's always been self-taught. A lot of YouTube tutorials, a lot of, you know, director's commentary and behind the scenes of movies and music videos and TV shows. And now there's a lot of podcasts with cinematographers and directors and various creative people where you can learn a lot of tools of the trade and techniques and equipment, but entirely self-taught for better or for worse.
Wow, that's impressive. Yeah.
My partner, Kevin, did double major in film and music. And so he had kind of the proper like film history, and he learned some of the stuff there. And I've picked up some of that from him. But for me, yeah, it was just a lot of Googling and YouTubing.
That's sweet. So yesterday in your masterclass, you kind of discussed your process a little bit. And what I was curious about was, it seems like 410 has two types of videos. There's like the live recording, or like kind of just the video of them playing it. And obviously it's very artistic in how you film it. But then there's also like the artistry side of it, where the video is the piece almost. And can you kind of explain what the difference is and how you decide which one to do when?
Yeah, it's a great question. That's always the big question right when an inquiry comes in for the first time, of like, what kind of video generally is this going to be? Does this need to be a performance-driven video, or can it be more abstract and conceptual? And oftentimes that is kind of dictated by the client, the performer or the composer. They might already know, like, I don't need to be in this, or they might feel very strongly like this piece is about watching me play it, and so it needs to be that. So there are definitely times when, and we've been doing this more and more recently, where people will come to us, you know, saying like, I want to film this piece, but I don't exactly know what kind of video, and we try and like edge them towards the more abstract conceptual side, because I think that's where the exciting, you know, creative stuff can come in. But it really depends project to project, and usually is dictated mostly by what the client wants. They usually have a pretty clear idea of what kind of video they want it to be. And it also plays into, you know, like release strategies and album, you know, promotion campaigns. And sometimes we'll do like in the same shoot or stretch of shoots, we'll do like one of each, for example. So it's like, we're going to be together already. Let's do a performance video of this, and then let's do something wild for this one, and we'll just release them at different times.
Yeah.
And so often, and I think this is what has kind of made 410 maybe stand out from others, is that we will try to just blend those however we can. So find a place kind of right in the middle, where it's a performance video, but we might go to a crazy location or apply some interesting technique to it. We just shot a video a couple weeks ago of a marimba solo where the first half of the video, the marimba is playing in the audio, but the performer is like getting dressed and walking onto stage to play it. And then they pick up the music about halfway into the piece.
Oh.
And so we watch them play the second half of it. So that's like exactly half and half, like performance versus more abstract. So that's always kind of the where we need to find where the project needs to lay. And there's a lot of factors, but we figure that out very, very early on.
And so for those projects, I assume like everything is all overdubbed. Like you're not actually recording audio in these productions?
Mostly, yeah. Some like we will try to get away sometimes with like we want to do an interesting thing, but also the audio needs to be captured live, and so we need to figure out how to do that. Which can be possible depending on the concept, but it can be easier to just be more creative with the visuals when you're not worried so much about note accuracy and making sound by moving the camera and, you know, all that.
And does sound have, like, I assume when you're recording at these locations, I'm watching So Percussion and Third Coast do these videos, does sound ever get you guys in trouble when you're recording? You know, they're hitting these big drums, like I would assume.
The drummers always get us in trouble, yeah. Yeah, that can be an issue. And I think, you know, starting out, I think we maybe assumed too often, like assumed things, or we would like show up to a location and just expect that it was going to be fine. And we've had enough kind of issues come up over shoots in the past that now we just know that communication and clarity is very, very important. And so, you know, if we do get a inquiry from Third Coast of a piece that has lots of loud drums, you know, and we're looking for location, we're just very upfront about that with the location, you know, rental manager, whoever it is, from the very beginning. I think we used to kind of just like cross our fingers and pray that it would be fine. But now our very first email is, this is going to be a loud piece. Is that going to be an issue?
Mm-hmm.
And it's good to just kind of work that out from the very beginning. And even once you do that, there's still possibility of like a rogue neighbor who you know, has an issue with it, and we just kind of have to deal with those things as they come up. But and that's, you know, that's another plus with pre-recording and overdubbing versus capturing live audio, is when we do loud drummy pieces, sometimes we'll, you know, swap the heads for mesh heads and do that kind of thing. Take the beater off of the kick drum pedal. Oh. So it like looks like you're playing it, but there's no sound being made. So most of the time when I'm filming drum set videos, I do a lot of that kind of stuff, like taping undersides of cymbals. And
I thought I saw in your fractions video that you had mesh heads on. I didn't want to say anything in the masterclass, but
I realized that kind of left it, that stayed in, and I was just hoping that so few people would notice that it wasn't worth
probably
it.
Probably only drummers, yeah.
Yeah, because that video I filmed outside and sound carried a lot, and that kind of was out of necessity, but yeah.
So you get an email from a client, you decide, you know what, we're going to take them on, this is a cool project. What happens next? Are you and your partner like sitting down and just listening to this over and over and creating a storyboard? Is that kind of the process?
That's pretty much exactly it. Listening to the music a lot from the beginning is like definitely the most important thing. And sometimes, you know, if we're asked to film a video for an upcoming release, the audio might not even be recorded or done yet. It's just like, I know I'm eventually going to want to film mm-hmm. this piece. Can we start planning it? And in that case, we always ask for a rehearsal recording or, you know, a live video or a MIDI mock-up, anything that like just gets us in the, you know, the vibe of the piece. But yeah, I'm always like in my car on the way to shoots, just listening to music over and over again and trying to think up what it could be. And sometimes it's really obvious, like, you know, we'll listen to a track and have an idea immediately. And sometimes it takes a lot more, just back and forth and, figuring it out. But, whether we actually, so for the more conceptual stuff, you know, Kevin and I will have our own kind of huddles and meetings, and we'll make a treatment that is like a, you know, PDF slideshow basically that has reference imagery and kind of tells roughly what's going to happen for each part of the track. And another thing that we've learned over the years is, yeah, you know, back when we were first starting, we would just have all these ideas and we'd shoot them without necessarily like having a lot of back and forth with the client. And there were a few times where there was just a disconnect with what they thought we were doing and what we knew we were doing. And those have been kind of some of the tougher situations we've been in as a company. And so like the clarity with the location thing, we just learned that that's extremely important. And reference imagery is very important for that and helpful. You know, we'll find other movies or music videos that have frames that we are kind of thinking what it's roughly going to look like. And that's really helpful working with musicians who might not have too much language and vocabulary for filmmaking to like understand what we're seeing, because that's not always clear. So yeah, we'll often send over, you know, drafts of PDFs that have kind of the treatment, the storyboard and reference imagery. And that helps us know exactly what we're going to get on the day and make sure we're on the same page. And some of that stuff's going to change, but at least we're like, you know, in the speaking the same language. And yeah.
Have you ever had an artist just go, whatever you want, like, I don't even want to know?
Yeah. That happens occasionally. And I, the verdict's still out on whether like what I prefer, cause it is nice to just know what the piece means to the player. And like, that can be a really nice, or the composer, that can be a really nice launching point. Sometimes it's actually like the choices are overwhelming when it's just, we're sent to track and it's like, do whatever you want. Mm. And it's like, ooh, I mean, I'll think of something. But even like, I actually just had a call this morning that was that conversation, which is like, I just want to hear like what, just give me a few words about what this piece means to you. And even like small stuff can be enough for us to kind of grab onto and start to think about. But it is also fun to have complete creative freedom. And that, yeah, we've definitely had projects like that in recent memory, and it's fun. You know, I have like a running doc, and I always save just reference images that I see and of just ideas that I think of randomly, like notes app, you know, whatever. And it's like, I don't know when this is going to come into play, but this could be a cool video in the future. And those are the times when that starts to come out, where it's like, you can do whatever you want. It's like, oh, well, maybe this is our chance to try this one thing that we have wanted to try, but didn't have another reason to. And yeah.
Nice. Well, I want to move towards like the student aspect. So what advice do you have to students that are trying to get like high quality recordings, either of their recitals or just like pieces that they think should have a nice recording? What advice do you have to them?
Good question. I feel like when people are starting out learning how like cameras and mics work, and they just want to know what like the first step to getting something high quality is, I think a lot of people have a kind of misconception that it's all in the camera or the mic, and it's always like, what camera should I get? That's like always the first question. But actually, the space that you're in and the lighting and the playing is all way more important than the camera and the mics. A really nice mic in a really bad room sounds horrible. And a not great mic in a beautiful sounding room can sound great. And same thing goes with lighting for video. Yeah, you can have a many, many tens of thousands dollar camera, but if you're shooting up against just like a gray wall with no depth or shape or anything, it's going to look bad. But I've also seen beautiful images taken on iPhones just because the lighting was good and they were oriented in the room in a good way and there was depth. And so I think, yeah, getting a basic on the video side, getting a basic sense of lighting and what works for light is really important and can take you a long way before you have to start spending money on expensive cameras and lenses. And so, and you know, for that, even just the basics of like photography, you know, like 3-point lighting setups for interviews or whatever it is. There's a million and one tutorials on YouTube of like how to light a face or how to light a person. And just general concepts about depth and yeah, how to be oriented in a room to make the most out of the space. And there are all sorts of resources on that and how to learn that. So yeah, I know it feels like a bit of a like maybe cop out on the technology side of things and the gear side, but just on the audio side, playing the piece well on a nice instrument with good like the proper mallets or whatever it is, will already go most of the way. And then it's just a matter of like learning the basics of where mics should generally be for how to record that instrument. And then same thing goes on the camera side. The room that you're in is the most important thing.
Yeah, you mentioned the room, but I want to kind of counterpoint that. Your videos on Instagram of you just like in your house, I assume, are like the best sounding and looking videos I think I've ever seen of just like what looks to be just normal practice. I was wondering what your process is for that. Like you just setting up a camera in your house and just recording or?
Yeah. I have a Fuji mirrorless camera that I mostly use for stills, but I set it up for video. And yeah, I mean, that is also like actually maybe a good example of that because I purposefully set up my kit and stuff under a skylight that I knew was just going to light me how I wanted it to. Granted, there are some setups that's in my attic. There are some setups that don't quite have the best lighting. Like when I'm back at the Vibes, there's no skylight there, but, but for the drums, I'm right under a skylight. And yeah, even that, like I have a little, you know, lamp with a Philips Hue bulb way in the back of the room just to get a little bit of, you know, pop a light in the back. And even though they're simple videos that are just a static, you know, tripod shot, I still try and like pepper in little things. And then, yeah, I mean, those are mostly just experiments and practice. And so that's also just messing with production and mixing as well. I kind of use those as a chance to just have some fun with how I can make things sound, you know, drum set. And I have like room mics and close mics and just, yeah, processing and mixing and figuring that out. So my home setup, you know, I do have a fair amount of mics like on the drums. There's a lot of close mics and room mics and all sorts of stuff. So that's not the simplest setup audio wise, but it's a nice sounding room. It's a very live, like, you know, A-frame room. And yeah.
Sweet. Well, we watched the 410 Media like highlight reel for 2024 yesterday, and I'll link that below. It's amazing. We're super excited to see what happens next. Is there any like favorite memories with 410 that you want to share?
Oh, favorite memories. I mean, there have definitely been some shoots that we've been on that have just been like pinch me moments. Also there are shoots that are very, very grueling and difficult and like they're just hard to get through. And then there are others that just feel more of like a field trip. Like we're just going to a cool place with our friends. And so I mean one that sticks out, I think for both Kevin and me, is we did a shoot with the Crossing Choir, great choir based in Philly. For a Michael Gordon piece, who's from the Bang on a Can camp. And we had access to this massive, like, privately owned ranch in Montana. This very, very wealthy family just owned this massive plot of land. And we took the entire choir out there to Montana and filmed a music video for this Michael Gordon piece. And that was really special because just, like, the views and where we were and... there was like a private chef there, and it's like stuff that we don't get at our shoots ever. Like we're always kind of hustling a little bit and being pretty scrappy. But that was one case where it was just a really fun experience, and we were in a beautiful location with great people. And then for the pinch me moment, I think I mentioned this yesterday at our class, but the recent shoot with Philip Glass, I think, was a very memorable thing. He's just been a big inspiration for me for a long time, and I know he has been for many people, and specifically because he has such a history with film scoring too, that, like, just the fact that we were filming this very famous film composer was honestly pretty intimidating, but just being behind the camera filming him playing piano was like, I had to stabilize a lot of, like, handshakes because I was shaking so nervously while I was holding the camera. But that was definitely a very memorable shoot recently.
That's sweet.
Yeah.
Do you have any artists that you are on your, like, bucket list of recording?
Oh, so many. I mean, we always like to shoot the music that we enjoy listening to. And so pretty much any time I find new music that I just like personally, I always, like, wish we could film a music video for it. And I think, like, we kind of have a bucket list of people that would just be amazing to work with, like our favorite bands, like Radiohead and Bon Iver. Whether that happens, I think, is time will tell. But I'm always listening to music, and I'm always like, man, it'd be cool to do a video for them. I doubt it'll ever happen, but it'd be cool.
That's awesome. Well, thank you so much for doing this. I appreciate you giving your time to us. And the concert last night was amazing. We're excited for tonight's concert and working with you. I just want to give you a moment to advertise any dates, events, or any sponsorships or anything you want to throw out there.
Yeah. Thanks for having me. Sponsors, Zildjian Cymbals, Vic Firth Sticks, Evans Drumheads. I play an SJC kit usually, which is a custom kit, so thanks to all them. As for dates, the program that I played last night here in Iowa is part of a collection of music that will be released later this year, which I'm very excited about. It's basically my first full-length album of original music, original solo music that I wrote and recorded for myself. I did one many years ago that I kind of don't count. So, so I'm very excited for that. So that'll be this fall. And I'm very active on Instagram as kind of the main place. So I think it's at Evan M. Chapman.
We'll have that link below too.
Cool.
Awesome. Sweet. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
All right, I hope you enjoyed today's episode. If you could take 30 seconds to follow us and share with a friend who also might find this information helpful, that would mean a lot. Follow us on social media. It means the world to know that this podcast is making a difference in your life. Keep practicing, performing, and learning. We'll be back soon with another episode.